Good morning, Oak Creek family. We are so thankful that you are joining us this morning. I hope you all had an amazing Thanksgiving, and I hope that you're not too stuffed and don't feel like you have a cinder block in your stomach like I do. Well, I kind of look that way too, but you know, it's a pleasure to be here with you all this morning. Hope that you all have had a good holiday and are excited to give praise and glory to our God and King. Just want to welcome you this morning and let you know that as an elder team, we are continuing to think through and discuss what our services look like moving forward, and we will make sure to keep you updated as far as the status for next Sunday, what that will look like, whether we'll be back in person or whether we will continue to be online. We will make sure to let you all know of that within the next couple of days. Stay up on online, on Facebook, on our website, and we will also be calling you and sending emails and letting you know what's going on. So without further ado, we are going to sing praise and worship to our God. So if you would, feel free to stay seated in your homes. You can stand up and sing with us, and let's give some praise to Jesus.
Every All right. Well, good morning, everybody on the watching this on the video. It feels weird playing this to an empty room. John was just up here when we were doing last week's service, and he mentioned just the weirdness of singing to an empty room, and it feels different from up here. So.
Strength arises, we wait upon the Lord, wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. Strength arises, we wait upon the Lord,
we will wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. You are the everlasting God, the everlasting God. You do.
As Mike mentioned during the announcement period, a big holiday just happened that, celebrating thanks. Yes, I am clearly talking about Black Friday. In the spirit of Thanksgiving, the actual holiday that we care about, this next song talking about, God's love and us being thankful for that, just something to be mindful of.
Thanks to the Lord, our God and King, His love endures forever. For His good, He is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise. But the mighty hand and an outstretched arms, His love endures forever. For the life that's been reborn, His love endures forever.
thank you, God, for this group of people that's willing to come here to help, you know, lead in worship, even though we don't get to see the people we're leading. Pray for all the people. You know, Thanksgiving is always a time of family and, you know, big get-togethers and dinners, and with what's going on in the world right now, a lot of people aren't getting that. And sure, that's making it hard to be thankful. God, I pray for all the people at home. Pray for all the people that actually are traveling. Keep them safe. And I pray for Todd as he's, gives the message for today. In your name I pray. Amen.
Good morning, boys and girls. It's Miss Lauren here today to share the children's lesson. But first, I have a question. Is anyone really hungry? Did anyone like maybe skip breakfast or could use a snack? Because I brought a snack. This is my snack. Doesn't it look delicious? Well, probably not for us, right? Does anyone know what this is? This is a dog treat. And right now, as I'm holding it, it smells pretty bad for me as a human. But who loves these kinds of things? Does anybody know? That's right. Dogs do. Dogs love dog treats. You can almost make a dog do anything for a dog treat. Sit, roll over, stop barking. When you train a dog, they're conditioned to do whatever it is you're asking them to because they're going to get a reward at the end. Is that really the right reason to do something? Probably not. But they're a dog and they're getting a treat. But sometimes I think we might do that with God, right? We act nice and we pray and we listen to our parents or do the right thing because we want a treat sometimes. We're also conditioned to want rewards. But God doesn't want us to love Him like that. Whether we have good times or bad times, God wants us to love Him because He loves us unconditionally. And He wants us to thank Him for all the things He's given us. There's someone in the Bible named Job who modeled this kind of love. God took all of the good things in Job's life away from him, but Job refused to walk away from God. Job said, "Naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked I will depart. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. May the name of the Lord be praised." So when good things happen, yes, we should rejoice and thank God. But let's not forget to thank God in the bad times, because no matter how bad things are, He is still God, and He still loves us.
So that's a great, great reminder for us, and really a good lead-in to what we're going to talk about today. I'm going to be in 1 Peter chapter 1, and for the next few weeks, I want to talk about joy. Before I get into the sermon, I just want to thank you for continuing to pray for us as a leadership team and praying for Heidi and I as we are recovering from coronavirus. I do want to let you know that the elders are going to meet here in a couple of days, and we'll make a decision going forward. But we want to encourage you to continue to protect yourself and your family and do everything that we can to help mitigate this coronavirus time. But I thought we would talk about joy today and for the next several weeks because I think joy is one of those great emotions that is tied to the Christmas season. And it's something that I think we're lacking in our society. This is one of the funny things is, as I've looked on Facebook and social media, how many people decided, you know what, it's 2020, we're going to put up our Christmas tree before Thanksgiving. And we did the same thing. We're all ready to go for that. But I want to remind you that Christmas should bring joy not just because of the season, the decorations, the holiday cheer, the festivities, the families that are able to get together, or even the gifts under the tree. But joy around Christmas time is because of what Christmas means. The incarnation, the doctrine and reality that God became a man in the person of Jesus Christ. That's the beginning of the gospel. Christ is God with us, Emmanuel. And when it comes to joy, whether at Christmas or any other time of the year, we need to look to Christ, because faith in Jesus Christ and the promise of the gospel is the foundation of our joy. If you want joy, then strengthen your faith. Increase your faith. I want to read from 1 Peter chapter 1 and just read this passage that's so rich in the blessing that God has given us in His Son. It says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to His great mercy, He has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice, though now for a little while, if necessary, you've been grieved by various trials, so that the tested genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold that perishes though it is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Though you have not seen Him, you love Him, and though you do not now see Him, you believe in Him and rejoice with joy that this is inexpressible and filled with glory, obtaining the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls." I want to explore the topic of joy this morning and finding joy, especially in the gospel. And so that's my first point this morning, is that the gospel is the source of our joy. We need to get beyond the idea that the gospel is merely something we just accept at the beginning of our relationship with God to be right with Him. The good news about Jesus, His death and His resurrection, is a whole life truth. It's the source of joy for believers. And so when you read verses 3 through 6 and all of the things that he speaks about here, this passage begins with an expression of joy. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. And whenever the Bible speaks of blessing God, it's an expression of joy on the person who is doing the blessing. John Piper shares what it means to bless God. He says it's to recognize and to give joyful expression to God's magnificence and His exalted status. It's a joyful exclamation in which we're expressing our gratitude to the Lord, our delight in the Lord, our delight in seeing and experiencing God for who He is and what He's done. And so what is this expression of joy? What is it that we have seen about God that results in this joyous response? And I want to tell you, it's His gospel. It's the good news of what God has done for us and the promise that we have in Him. See, this is one of those texts that kind of makes my head spin, because it's a summary text and every phrase is significant. It's really impossible to fully preach all of these concepts in one sermon. So I would encourage you to take time to study and to meditate and contemplate on all that God has done for us in Christ. But what this passage does do is gives me a platform to give the application at the very outset of the sermon. And this is the application for you today. You must learn to meditate daily on gospel truths and preach the gospel to yourself as the regular, joy-sustaining, growth-producing practice of your life. Let me say that again. We need to learn to meditate daily on gospel truths and preach the gospel to ourselves as the regular, joy-sustaining, growth-producing practice of our lives. The gospel is the source of our joy, and the more that we meditate on the gospel, the stronger our faith becomes, and the deeper our love grows, and the greater our joy. And so, note Paul's summary of the gospel in this passage. First, the gospel is based on His great mercy. And sometimes we miss the good news because we forget or downplay the bad news. The cross is a picture of God's mercy. It's not one of us who is in Christ that's getting what he deserves. If you go back to Romans chapter 3, verse 23, we remember that it teaches that all of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. I know that I've sinned, I know that you've sinned, all of us have sinned, and we've fallen short of the glory of God. And as Paul lays out the gospel in the book of Romans, he gets to the place in chapter 6 where he teaches us that the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. You think about that phrase, the wages of sin is death. What he's really talking about is the wrath of God on sin. He's talking about death and hell and the punishment for our sin. But the free gift of God is eternal life. And so the cross, first and foremost, is a picture of God's mercy in his great mercy. And then he says that he has caused us to be born again. You know, Jesus told Nicodemus in John chapter 3, you must be born again. And unless you're born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God. The new birth means that we have a new life, a spiritual one. You know, in 2 Corinthians 5, where it says that if anyone's in Christ, he's a new creation. The old things have passed away. All things have become new. And here in this passage in 1 Peter, Paul's saying that God has caused us to be born again. God has given us that new life, that new birth, when we put our faith and trust in him. So he says he's caused us to be born again. Then he says, to a living hope. You realize this is a living hope. It's not a dead hope. It's not a false hope. You know, a few years ago, one of the things that was going around was a practical joke at Christmas time. And they had these fake lottery tickets. And so what a lot of people were doing that year is they would buy three or four lottery tickets from the store, and then they would throw in there this fake one. And so when you scratch it off, you're a big winner of hundreds of thousands of dollars. And the trick is that it's not a real lottery ticket, and then you had to break the news to them. Well, that would be a false hope, the hope that you've won when you really have not. But what we have in Christ is not a false hope that may or may not be true. It's not a dead hope that we're believing in something false. It's a living hope because Christ has risen from the dead. He is alive, and he promises new life to all who put their faith in him. So through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, the resurrection is our guarantee of the hope of the gospel. We know we have hope because Christ rose from the grave. And so we have a living hope. Then he says in verse 4, to an inheritance that's imperishable, undefiled, unfading, kept in heaven for you. See, God is keeping an inheritance for us. Someday we're going to spend eternity with Christ, and we're going to receive that inheritance that God is holding for us. Remember what Jesus told his disciples in John 14, I go to prepare a place for you, and I'm going to come again so that you may be where I am. So God's keeping an inheritance for us. And then verse 5 says, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. Now, there's a whole lot that we can unpack there, but I want to just bring out that God is the one that's keeping us. He's guarding us through our faith, that we're secure in him. It's a promise to us of eternal life. And so that's why when we get to verse 6, he says, in this you rejoice. See, we can have joy because in Christ we're spared from God's judgment. We're given a new life. We have an inheritance waiting for us, and not an empty hope, but a living one, guaranteed. God's at work in us, keeping us until that day. And in all of this, we rejoice. And that's why I say that the gospel is a source of joy. If you want to grow in joy in your life, remind yourself continually of these gospel truths. And as many as have put it, and as I've repeated many times in sermons at Oak Creek, preach the gospel to yourself. Meditate on the gospel. I like a list in the book, The Cross-Centered Life. The author gives several ways you can do that, and I commend them to you. One of those things is you can memorize the gospel. You know, all God's promises and commands are precious and powerful, but those verses that tell us of the Son of God who gave his life in our place are the most precious and powerful of all. That's a quote from the book. But my personal favorite gospel verse is 2 Corinthians 5:21. God made him who knew no sin to be sin for us so that we might become the righteousness of God. Many of you have learned John 3:16, and if you've not, that's a great verse to be your first. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Whosoever believeth in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. I memorized it in the King James, and I know it also in another translation. But those verses where we're just reminded of the gospel truths, and as you're reading in your devotion and you find one of those verses that are so compelling that shares the gospel, commit it to memory and rehearse it in your mind. One of the other things that we can do is pray the gospel. The author says the gospel should be at the center of your prayer life because it makes it possible for us to approach God. So I think it's appropriate when we're praying to take a moment and thank God for what he's done. Lord, thank you for saving me. Thank you for coming into my heart and my life. Thank you for sending your son Jesus to die for my sin that I can be a child of you. Another way is that we sing the gospel. I'm so appreciative of John. He chooses gospel-saturated songs, and week after week, we're singing the gospel. We're singing the good news of what God has done for us. You may take a moment and just kind of review and think about how the gospel has changed you. Think about how you have grown as a man of God, as a woman of God, because of the gospel, because of what Christ has done in your life. And then you can study the gospel. One of the books that I love is John Stott's The Cross of Christ. But there's so many resources that you can dig into God's word, and especially the gospel. Those are just a few ways, but I don't want to go a day without thinking about the gospel and what God has done for me. And so that kind of rounds out our first point. Can I add to that as we look at verses 6 and 7? Number 2, authentic faith leads to unshakable joy. Authentic faith leads to unshakable joy. Look at verses 6 and 7. He says, "In this you rejoice, though now for a little while, if necessary, you've been grieved by various trials, so that the tested genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ." Now, this is what I want to share with you. For our joy to be unshakable, the source of that joy has to be something other than our present situation, our present circumstance. And know the relationship here. On the one hand, it's our faith in the gospel and our hope of salvation that sustains us in the midst of trials. And it's trials that demonstrate the genuineness of our faith. Peter gives this illustration of testing gold. I remember when I was a child, we had a store that we liked to go in after school that was a coin shop right on the corner in Dowagiac. And, we'd go and look at the coins, and he bought gold and did all these things. Well, one day I found a ring. And so I took it to the coin shop because it said on the inside 10K, and I knew that meant 10 carat. And so I took that ring to the coin shop, and he looked at the ring and he showed me two other letters, EP, 10 carat electroplated. And I said, "What does that mean?" He says, "There's so little gold on there, it's just covering the top, and there's a metal underneath that is not real." He said, "If I were to put it in this purification, it would melt all the other metals, and the gold would rise to the top, and all you would have is just a little flake of gold." Now, I remember that day I was kind of disappointed because I thought I'd found a treasure. But when gold is purified, when it's heated up, the impurities rise to the top. They're burnt up. Heat is the way in the old time, and even now, that you purify gold. And so the thing is, faith is more precious than gold, because one day gold is going to perish, but authentic faith is not going to perish. I found in my own life that trials are often kind of show me where my walk with Christ is. It's been a measure of my faith, and sometimes it's a measure of my lack of faith. And that faith in turn, when God produces it in my life, becomes a source of joy that sustains me through trials. And you know, Heidi and I were thinking of just all of the hard times that we've been through over the years, and the choices that we've made in ministry. And the reality is that God has sustained us through those, because our hope is in Him. Our hope is in the gospel and all of those other things that worry us are those impurities that when tested by fire, they rise to the top. And God wants us to have that pure and genuine faith. And that happens when our faith, when our love, when our joy is sustained not by the things happening around us, but on the fact that God is good and faithful and loves us and he's for us and that he's given his life for us. And so Peter is in effect saying the same thing as Paul did in Romans 8, 28 and 29, you know, that all things work together for good for those who are called by God according to his purpose. And that whom he foreknew, he predestined to be conformed to the image of his son. There's a design to the trials that God allows in our life to test us and refine us and increase our faith and to help us to learn. Now, this is the thing I've had to learn over and over, and I'm still learning, but to help us to learn to find our joy only in him and to prepare us for when we're going to spend eternity with him. So our hope is sustained by joy. Our hope in the midst of trials is not based on the idea that our present situation is going to change for the better. Here's the fact, it may or it may not. You know, our situation may not change for the better. Trials help to produce in us, though, an authentic faith that leads to joy. Joy in the midst of trials shows that our faith is genuine, shows that our faith is in God and not in our circumstance, that our hope is not in the present situation, but it's on God's eternal grace for us. And so joy is produced by, unshakable joy is produced by faith. Thirdly, and I want to look at verses 8 and 9 here. Joy is magnified as we love and trust in God. Joy is magnified as we love and trust in God. Verse 8 says, though you have not seen him, you love him. And though you do not now see him, you believe in him and rejoice with joy that is inexpressible and filled with glory, obtaining the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. Here's what Peter's doing. He's telling them what they're feeling. He's really validating their emotions here. He's saying, you don't see him now. You know, there's times in our life where we just don't see God at work. And the reality is I've not seen God face to face. I'm looking forward to that day. But I love him. You know, I trust him. And Christianity is not first and foremost about doing things. It's about love. It's about faith that results in joy. John Piper puts it this way. True Christianity is loving Christ and trusting Christ and enjoying Christ. Remarkably, Peter's writing to people like ourselves who had not seen Jesus face to face. They had come to know him through the testimony of others, through the testimony of the apostles, and through the preaching of the gospel. They had not seen him face to face. But what Peter is getting at here, and what you know, if you know Christ, you know this. They had not merely embraced a set of truth claims. They had embraced a person, God in the flesh. So when we think about Christmas and God becoming a man and living the perfect life that we couldn't live and dying on the cross and rising again and inviting us into relationship with him, we're not talking about just one more religion where we have this set of truths and you have that set and whatever works for you works for me. No, what we're doing is we're recognizing that God has come into this world and he invites us into relationship with him. So my faith is not in a set of facts. My faith is in a person. My faith is in God. And so Peter says, even though you've not seen him, you love him. You trust him. You're filled with joy because of him. Folks, this is what I want for you. This is what I want for me. Even though we've not seen him, we love him and trust him and are filled with joy because of him. So in one sense, joy in Christ is the deep good feelings in loving and believing him. You know, as our love increases and our faith increases, our joy is magnified. And Peter adds in verse 9, in this you are now progressively That's the tense of the verb there. You're now progressively receiving the goal of it all, the salvation of your soul. That there's this future salvation, the final full salvation that's yet in the future, but we're right now receiving for our souls now, in part, as we love Christ, as we trust Christ, as we rejoice in Christ, we're receiving that saving work of God as he sanctifies us and draws us closer to him and makes us like Christ. And joy is the natural byproduct of faith and love. If you want to grow in joy, then develop your love and your trust of Christ. And that goes back to my original application. To grow in love and faith, and thus joy, continually keep the gospel at the forefront of our minds and our thoughts. John MacArthur states this, and this is an admonishment to us. Do not let one day go by without taking the time to dwell on him, who he is, what he's done, and what he's doing for you. You know, we need to learn to meditate on gospel truths. We need to preach the gospel to ourselves as a regular, joy-sustaining, growth-producing practice in our lives. Folks, I don't know where you're at today. Some of you I know are struggling. Some of you are lacking in joy, and I want to pray for you. I know we're not in person today. Some of you have been watching online for several months. Some of you have been coming, and for these couple of weeks, maybe more, we're not meeting. But listen, I want you to know that I'm praying for you. And God does not want you to have a joyless Christianity. God wants you to have joy in him. And we're going to be talking about this for the next few weeks. But I wanted to start with just the reality that the gospel is the source of our joy. Let me say our application one more time. Learn to meditate daily on gospel truths and preach the gospel to yourself as a regular, joy-sustaining, and growth-producing practice in your life. Let me pray for you. Father, I thank you for this day. I thank you for the technology that allows us to gather online and worship you and hear from your word. And Lord, as I think about what Peter summarizes here in the gospel, just sharing with us who you are, what you've done for us, so that we recognize that joy comes from you. Lord, I know that I need joy in my life, and often I'm lacking in joy. And I know there's some people listening right now, watching, that are struggling. God, some are struggling because of the holiday season and are grieving the loss of loved ones. Others are struggling just because coronavirus is taking a toll on all of us. It might be something even completely different. But Lord, I lift them up to you right now and pray, God, that each person in the sound of my voice would feel a special sense of your presence and your care for them, that they would have the peace that passes understanding, that they would know that you love them and know what you've done for them. God, I pray if there's anyone that's watching and doesn't know you, that Lord, right there in their living room, God, they would call out to you and believe that you died for their sins and rose again, and invite you into their heart and their life, putting their faith in you and turning to you. God, I pray that you would continue to sustain us by that gospel. Help us to renew our minds and refresh our spirit as we meditate and study and just think about all of the things that you've done for us in Christ. God, I pray for everyone today in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for watching online today. I do want to remind you that you can find this sermon later in the day and all of our material on oakcreekvideos.com. If you go to our church webpage, oakcreekchurch.com, you can fill out the online connection card if you're a guest watching the show today. And there's also a place for online giving. And I want to encourage you, if you're part of Oak Creek, to continue in giving your tithes and offerings. Starting next week, we're going to start taking up the Lottie Moon Christmas offering. If you'd like to give to the Lottie Moon Christmas offering, you can do that online. And there's a drop-down spot where instead of general fund, you drop down to where it says Lottie Moon. So if you want to give to Lottie Moon, it'll be a separate transaction from your regular tithes and offerings, but you can do that on the online gift, even if we're not meeting together in person. Just remind you, Lottie Moon is a missions offering. We'll talk more about that next week, but it 100% of that offering goes to put missionaries on the field to take the gospel to the nations. And so we want to rejoice in the gospel, and we want to share it with others. So, you know, that's our mission. We want to make Jesus known where we are and around the world as we follow him together. Have a great week, and we'll see you soon.